The fact is that research makes you a more competitive medical school applicant. With Canadian medical school admissions being as competitive as they are, I am going to help you become a more competitive applicant by getting established in research. If you are new here, my name is Dani Kilani. I'm a first-year medical student in Canada. I was involved in research from grade 11 up until the day I received my medical school acceptance. I've personally gone through the process of getting a research position 5 separate times for 5 separate summer research experiences. I've also advised numerous students successfully and for free on how they can go about getting research positions in Canada. I'll start off by telling you about how you should get in contact with professors that have the potential to offer you a research position. Then I'll share with you how you can write your emails in the most compelling way possible to almost guarantee that you get a response back. To end off, we'll go into what an interview looks like, as well as some potential sources of funding for your research. Before we get into it, like and subscribe to the channel for more on medical school admissions, mindsets, and more. Most commonly, the first step in finding a research position is to identify possible labs and researchers that you would like to be working with. This means identifying research topics that are interesting to you and finding professors who are working on research in those topics. I've given talks and done Q&As on how to get a research position, and one of the most common questions that I get is how do I find professors and their contact information? I'm going to give you a quick tutorial on how to do this, and it's going to look a little bit different depending on which research institution or which university you are looking to work at. For the sake of an example, let's say that I'm interested in cardiology research and that I'm an undergraduate student at the University of Toronto. So I Google University of Toronto cardiology researchers and click the most relevant result. Then I click the link for cardiology faculty listing on that page. Where you'll find a list of faculty who are doing research is going to be different depending on the research institution. From there, I can click on a researcher's profile, see what their research interests are, and get their contact information. Getting an idea of what the researcher is working on is going to be important in catering your email to each specific lab. I'll go into more depth on how you can cater your emails to different labs in just a little bit. Writing your first cold email is probably the most difficult part of the process. But once you've got a general template down that you can customize for each specific researcher, things become a lot easier going from there. Let's start off with some general tips before I get into a tried and true template that I've used to get all of my research positions. Number one is to keep your emails as succinct as possible. Remember that researchers are busy people. They get tons and tons of emails every day. So make sure you're being respectful of their time by being short and clear with your email. Number two is to not get too quickly discouraged if you don't hear back from your first few emails. If things are not going your way with your emails, try a few different writing styles and see which ones get you the best response rates. Number three is to remember that luck plays a huge role in the process. There are so many external factors that determine whether or not you receive a response back, so don't be too hard on yourself. My last tip before we get into the template is a great one if you can find the right situation to use it in. See if you can make initial contact with a professor by asking a small question that shows your interest in their field. I have done this before by attending talks held by researchers at my university and listening to the talk, finding a question that piques my interest, and sending to them by email after the talk. Once I got a response back, it created that initial relationship between me and the researcher, allowing me to ask if there were any undergraduate research opportunities available, with my interest so clearly demonstrated. The professor was taken aback by how curious and interested I was in his research and invited me to work in his lab. That position made a huge difference in my medical school application and led me to get numerous international conference invitations. Now for the email itself. I always open my emails by giving a very brief description about myself, including what I'm studying, where I'm studying, as well as my GPA. Then state why you are emailing them, ideally by the second or third sentence. You can then write a few sentences in another paragraph about what interests you about their work. One of the biggest mistakes I see in emails is people rehashing the details of that researcher's latest paper. As an undergraduate student, doing this is usually just an opportunity to embarrass yourself by mucking up some of the details. Additionally, the researcher is one of the authors of the paper you are summarizing, so it's a waste of their time to hear about something that they know so much about. Instead, talk about the general characteristics of their work and why it piques your interest. For example, if they work on hypertension, say why that interests you. You should also try and show some previous experiences that can demonstrate your interest in their work. This could be volunteer positions, coursework, or leader positions that you've included on your resume that demonstrate that you are interested in their general area of research. In a new paragraph, I would also give a brief summary of any skills you might have that would be highly sought after in a lab environment. I personally learned how to code in R, which is a programming language that's used for statistical analysis in many research environments. This definitely gave me a leg up in getting many of my positions. In fact, I always tell students looking for research positions that they should work on improving their ability to code in R or Python, since most labs would appreciate having these skills in their research students. Alternatively, you could also write about what kinds of experiences you have with laboratory skills such as PCRs or culturing bacteria that are specifically used in the labs that you're applying to. If you don't have transferable skills, don't worry too much, since research environments tend to be learner-oriented. You'll be surrounded by numerous master's or PhD students in the lab that can help you learn the basics. Near the end of your email, you should restate what you're hoping to get from them. I usually ask about an opportunity to chat about possible research positions in their lab. In terms of attachments, you definitely want to include a CV or resume, as well as your most recent transcript. I say to include these right off the bat because you do not want to be wasting their time by making them ask for these documents that they'll almost certainly want anyways. As a side note, if you're just starting university out of high school and don't have a university transcript yet, don't worry about sending one until you have one. When applying to positions during my first semester of university, I just sent my high school transcript and explained that I would send a university transcript once I had my first semester grades back. You should also offer to provide any other information or documents that they need to make a decision. Once you've sent and composed your first email, do not stop at one. Try and write at least one email every day to a new researcher. You will get better at writing emails tailored to specific researchers over time. I have met people who have sent hundreds of emails just to get a single research position. I've also been at the other end of the spectrum, where I usually send a maximum of 15 emails per year to land one position. Remember that if you don't get a response back, it doesn't hurt to send a follow-up email after a week or so. Sometimes researchers intend to respond to your email, but become overwhelmed with upcoming deadlines and forget. So sending follow-up emails has the potential to increase your response rate significantly. Most professors will want to meet you before they commit to taking you on as a student researcher. In my experience, these interviews have always been fairly informal conversations with either the principal investigator or a graduate student. The goal of the interview for them is to try and get to know you and see if you would be a good fit for the lab. You'll probably also receive a tour of the lab if you're doing it in person, but you might not get that virtually. I have personally never had an interview that did not turn into a research position. So if you got an interview, you are definitely on the right track. I'll rattle off some quick tips for the interview based on my experiences. Number one is to make sure to show up early. You want to demonstrate that you are responsible and that you could make a commitment to their lab and follow through with it. Number two, be ready to meet new people. They want to see a friendly person who can get along with the other members of their lab. Number three, actively show your interest by asking insightful questions. The expectation for an undergraduate student is that you are there to learn, so asking these questions shows that you are prepared to do that. Number four, figure out if this is a lab that you actually want to be working at. Since this is a place that you are going to be committing a lot of time to, you want to make sure that this experience is going to be able to provide you with what you want to get out of it. For new students, the opportunity to learn new skills is usually enough. For more senior students, you may be looking towards the potential to get published and present your work at conferences. Lastly, the interview is rarely intended to be a test of your knowledge, so don't pretend to know more than you do. I have done this before, and you will definitely get called out on it. I'll briefly touch on funding, with the caveat that this is going to be slightly different depending on which research institution you are looking to work at. It's usually easiest to get funding at the academic institution that you are studying at, since they tend to set aside some money towards summer research opportunities for their own students. Usually the professors at each institution will be fairly familiar with the funding available for summer research students. This includes both university-specific grants as well as grants from institutions outside of the university, such as NSERC. Another thing to consider is that some researchers have huge amounts of funding for their lab already, of which a small amount could go towards hiring a summer research student. Being paid directly out of lab funding has happened to me twice out of my 5 summer research experiences. Typically, to get funding from grants, you will need to fill out an application with your research supervisor. These applications commonly tend to open in January and close around the end of February. So if you're watching this video when it was initially posted, kudos to you for getting started early. If you're looking to get started with a research position during the fall or winter semesters, I highly encourage you to consider volunteering for a lab. Most labs do not have money set aside for paying students during the fall or winter semesters, so volunteering is the best option at that time. Volunteering also gives you the opportunity to figure out whether or not the lab is worth committing a full summer to, and if it isn't, you have time to look for other opportunities. There are also some hospitals that fund summer research programs, with the most notable being the SickKids Summer Research Program, and I'll link to that in the description. With all of that information, I'd like to encourage you to try sending out at least one email today. It doesn't have to be perfect, but sending out that first email is your first step in getting involved in research and improving your chances at medical school admissions along the way. I want to get to know my audience better, so let me know what topic of research you are looking to get into. If you enjoyed this video, feel free to check out my others. I've done one on a Q&A about medical school admissions and another about how I take notes in medical school. Thanks, team, and I'll see you all in the next one.